Good morning and welcome to worship with Centenary United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Michelle and delighted to be in worship with you this morning. Thank you for joining us. I invite you to make yourself comfortable and just be aware of the presence of God with you as we go into our worship service. We'll have about a half an hour with some music and prayers, a scripture, and then a message about the ways that God is with us in this time. Centenary continues to be in ministry in powerful ways in this season, and I invite you to support that, the ways that we are in ministry, through, you can go to the MankatoCentenary.org website, there's a donate button at the bottom of that page, or sending checks into our office, our staff are caring for that. And thank you to all of you who are continuing to do that and are helping us to be in ministry to our neighborhood.
As we begin this morning, just a few announcements for you. If you have any pastoral care concerns, we encourage you to contact Pastor Michelle, either through her email or by leaving a message on her phone at the church. We invite you to connect with us online throughout the week. On Wednesday evenings, I invite families and those young at heart to join me for Stories from the Coop at 7 o'clock live on Facebook. If you miss it, you can always go back and watch it again. And each evening at 5 o'clock, we invite you to join either myself or Pastor Michelle on our Facebook Live feed for our 501 devotion time. It's about 5 minutes of a blessing or a poem or a thought for the day and our 501 prayer. It's a great opportunity for us to connect and remind each other of the Spirit's work in this time and of the community that we have together. Now, as we prepare for worship this morning, I invite you to settle in to the space where you are today. I invite you to take a deep breath and to relax into this time of worship together. As we come together in community this morning, these are the prayers that are before us. We pray for our world and for our community, for a world in the midst of a pandemic. We lift up prayers for the healthcare workers and those on the front lines, and for all who are grieving, for loved ones, for those who shelter alone, and for those who are sick. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up prayers for the church, a reminder that we are Easter people. Even in the chaos of this present time, we search for hope. We lift up the ways that the church continues to lead in this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up prayers for our partners in our building, including Minnesota Council of Churches Refugee Services, Ark of Minnesota, and the Mankato Korean Congregation, and for the ministries of Centenary, for our continued bonds and connection, for leadership that is willing to pivot and work in this time and in this place, for those who are continuing to be served through the Connection Shelter and Holy Grounds. We pray that God will continue to break through at Centenary and in each and every one of our own lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up these specific prayers for members of our church family this morning. Prayers of comfort for the family of Sheila Herkey, who died last Sunday, and for the family of Beth Wells, who died a week ago. We also lift prayers of comfort this morning for Jackie Schmidt. We lift healing prayers today for Bob and Mary Ann Bench, Roxanne Johnson, Jim Pfeffer, Marcine Klunder, Julie Thorlifson, Jim Holman, Steve Swanson, and Anne-Marie Johnson's mother, Susan. I now invite you to join with me in the familiar words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now I invite you to join with me in our opening prayer. You'll find the words printed on the screen. O God of time, you have organized our days with the sun and the moon, with seasons and stars. We mark our days and order them. We record our history and recite it. We buy calendars and plan for the future. Time moves on, sweeping us along. Yet we are in a season when events have reshaped time. There is a jagged boundary between before and after. We are counting the days since we have been apart from one another. Our calendars are a mess as plans are rewritten. We are not sure what is next. Some say this is a liminal time, those strange moments between dream and reality, a time when our usual counting stops or slows, and you reveal something to us in the midst of our unease. You are also the author of Kairos, Holy Time. You break into our history, our calendars, our plans with a new way of being, like you did on Easter so long ago after counting 3 days in the tomb. Mark our time, O God. Enter into our strange days with dream possibilities. Write holy time into our days and hearts. Lift us out of our unease into the surety of your time, which transcends human history and the memory of stars. Make our time holy as you are holy. Amen.
Wake up to the sunlight with your windows open. Don't hold in your anger or leave things unspoken. Wear your red dress and use your good dishes. Make a big mess and make lots of wishes. And have what you want, but want what you have. And don't spend your life looking back. Turn up the music, turn it up loud. Take a few chances, let it all out, 'cause you won't regret it. Looking back from where you not who you knew, and it's not what you did, it's how you live. So go to the ball games, and go to the ballet, and go see your folks more than just on the holidays. Kiss all your children, dance with your wife, tell your husband you love him every night. Don't run from the truth, 'cause you can't get away. Oh no, just face it, you'll be okay. Turn up the music, turn it up loud. Take a few chances, looking back from where you have been. 'Cause it's not who you knew, and it's not what you did, it's how you live. Give to the needy and pray for the grieving, even when you don't think that you can. 'Cause all that you do is bound to come back to you. Think of your fellow man and make peace with God and make peace with yourself. Oh yes, 'cause in the end there's nobody else. Turn up the music, turn it up loud. Take a few chances, let it all out, 'cause you won't regret it. Looking back from where you have been, 'cause it's not who you knew, and it's not what you did, it's how you live. 'Cause it's not who you are, and it's not what you did, it's how you live.
After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We'll go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, do you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast your net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and he jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead.
Every time I look at the gospel stories, it seems to me that they are a little bit different. I've preached on this story several times, and it looks different to me this year, as if our context changes our eyes in the ways that we see the story. I think that the stories are so rich that they can speak to us across the generations and for a new time. So think about this story. I've never really quite understood it. So the disciples are, they're completely freaked out. Let's just be clear about that. They watch Jesus be arrested. And then they know that he was crucified, and they're aware of how awful that was. And then they went into hiding because they were afraid that maybe they would be arrested as well. And then they started hearing reports from the women that Jesus had risen, and they had a couple of experiences where Jesus, you know, showed up through locked doors and greeted them. And so they're just completely, totally freaked out. And so what do? Well, they go fishing. I've never quite understood that, but in some ways now it looks different to me. These disciples had had their lives completely disrupted. They were afraid. They weren't going to be able to go back to what life was like before, and they had no idea what the future would look like for them. And so they're in this moment where they're hiding, they're afraid, they aren't sure about the past or the future. Things have happened that are just completely changing their worldview. And so what do? They go to a very familiar activity. Fishing is very familiar. Most of the disciples were fishermen. And so it's an activity that was familiar, and I bet it brought comfort to them. So if you think about it, and I know that Minnesotans love fishing an awful lot. For these guys, when they fish, they get their boat, They get in their boat, they've got their equipment, they row out into the Sea of Galilee, and then they take their nets and they put them over the side and they pull them in. And they're fishing at night, and I'm not quite sure why they were doing that, but they're fishing at night, and so they're just, you know, doing the same motions, the rowing, the putting the nets in, and the taking them out. They were so familiar with these physical actions that they probably didn't even need to talk to each other while they did it. Perhaps they did. Perhaps it was a good time to talk about how freaked out they were or what was going on, or maybe not to talk about that at all. But they spent the whole night doing this very familiar activity, this very familiar thing that their bodies deeply knew how to do. Maybe it brought a sense of normalcy to them. Maybe it brought some comfort. I'm preaching this month on visible mending, which is this idea that sometimes we have scars or disruptions in our lives, in our bodies, in the things around us, in our communities, and there are ways that we can mend them, but you can't hide the scar. You often can still see it. So I'm thinking about the way that routine does that. Routine is like a thread that moves through our day and binds the new and the old together, and is something that connects us and provides a strong fabric to hold us together. So what sort of routines do you have in your life that bring you comfort and that include some physical memory, or that happen at the same time every day, or just those patterns that shape your day? Now, I know our time has been disrupted in huge ways, and we've had to reorganize the ways that we spend our days and that we spend our time, most of us. So some of us have developed new patterns, new routines, and some of the old ones still can bring us comfort. William McGravy is a Navy admiral, and he gave a great commencement speech about how to change the world. And he talked about one really important way to change the world, which is really a very routine kind of activity. He talks about making your bed every day. So let's do that. Let's see what it might be like to make your bed. That's Admiral William McGraven, who talks about the importance of making your bed. And he's referring to the military practice of making your bed right away in the morning in a very crisp and clear way. He talks about the way that this is a small action, and if you do a small action well, then you can do large actions well also. And he also says that even if you've had a terrible day, when you come back at the end of the day, you'll have a bed that is beautifully made. I also think that making a bed can be a way of praying. And so you make a bed, and for instance, in this bed, I can be grateful that I have a bed. I can be thankful for my house, for my cats. I remember my mother who made this quilt and gave it to me. And then also Ginny, who made me this pillow here, and so I can pray and give thanks for that. And I can also pray for others that I know are not in a bed. I know that I sleep better when our Holy Grounds and Connection Shelter guests are sleeping in a bed. And this last month, because of a collaboration with Connection Shelter and the city and some local businesses, our guests have been able to be in a bed. But tonight that ends, and some of our friends will be on the streets tomorrow. So that changes my sense of what it means to have a bed and my own routine. But there's something powerful about this routine of making your bed. You always have a bed of some sort. Even our friends who are sleeping on the streets, they have something that they're using to sleep on, some way that they put it away at the end of the day. And we all have beds. We all get up in the morning. We all go back at the end of the day. Our whole lives. And so these experiences layer together, and making the bed is like a visible mending of our days. It ties together this day with all the other days and all the other beds and all the other times that we have pulled them to order, and we have set the stage for the rest of our day and for the night. It's a way of visibly mending our days by our routines. And now it's ready for my cats. What kind of routines are shaping your days? Some of you have told me some beautiful stories of the ways that you start your days, you end your days, times with family, routines that you've always had, routines that you've created that are new. But these routines take our days and they connect our the old days and the new days with this common rhythm, and it's like a thread running through them, holding them together. What are your routines? I invite you to share those on Facebook or on our YouTube chat and just let one another know, what are the routines that are holding your days together in a meaningful way right now? Eugene Peterson, who wrote The Message, wrote an article about how, of course, the disciples had to go fishing. They had encountered the resurrection, not only just all of the trauma, but the resurrection. Their whole idea of the world had been turned upside down, and so they needed to do something very normal, that they deeply knew. And so they brought the concept of the resurrection into their workday to try to make some sense of it, and also they brought their workday to the understanding of the resurrection. So it's trying to weave this new thread into the pattern of that routine. And we can say, oh, sure, they did. Of course, they went fishing and they saw Jesus, right? Well, don't we see Jesus in these events? Don't we see Jesus? Can't we see Jesus in these routine activities in our lives? In washing dishes, in gardening, in going for a walk, in our calls with our families, in the everyday activities that we have? What we're talking about are two different kinds of time coming together. We have Chronos, which is the time that we use to mark on our calendars, the time that has been so terribly disrupted lately, and Kairos, which is holy time, it's God time, which interrupts our routines and our everyday. And so as we are weaving our routines together and weaving our Chronos together, God enters in with Kairos and says, I am here. The presence of the Holy is with you. It's like Jesus on the beach waiting for the disciples who had been up all night doing this very familiar activity, as if the act of fishing and the act of that kind of repetitive motion helped them to be able to see that it was Jesus on the shore. How do the routines of our days help us to see the presence of the Holy, which is always with us and is always interrupting us? Resurrection, new life, Kairos, God's presence is always entering into our life, if only we can see it. So may your routines be a blessing to you. May they mend your lives and your days. And in those routines, may you encounter the presence of the Holy One. Be blessed. Amen.